sons of men and angels say, Alleluia. Raise your joys and triumphs high, Alleluia. Sing ye heavens and earth reply, Alleluia. Lives again King, Alleluia. Where, O death, is now our sting, Alleluia. Dying once, he all does say, Alleluia. Where thy victory, O grave, redeeming work is done, Alleluia. Fought the fight, the battle won, Alleluia. Death in vain forbids him rise, Alleluia. Christ has opened
Good morning. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Can you imagine those guards outside that tomb? They were sleeping before he was turning up.
God sent his son. He lived and died. Jesus, my Savior, vainly they sealed the tent. Jesus, my Lord, up from the grave.
I Hello and happy Easter to you all. We are glad you could join us. We're going to indulge in a little bit of an experiment here and try to make this a little bit interactive. And Lori doesn't know this, but she's going to be my guinea pig here. I forgot to tell her about this earlier. So there is an Easter tradition in the modern evangelical church where every Easter, it seems like in churches all over the place, the pastor says, "Christ is risen," and the church responds with,
"He is risen indeed."
He is risen indeed. So if you don't know that tradition, I just taught it to you. So what we're going to do as an experiment is I want you to, wherever you're at right now, if you're looking at your TV and watching on TV, go to the nearest window in your room. Open the window, okay? If you have your phone with you, I encourage you to go to the front door on the patio or on the back deck, whatever is closest. And on the count of three, after we've given you a little bit of time to position yourselves so that you are out in the open, I am going to say on the count of three, "Christ is risen." You are going to respond at the top of your lungs with "He is risen indeed." Okay, and we're gonna shout it out so that the whole world hears this truth that we declare on Easter. So I'm hoping everybody is in position. So ready? One, two, three. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Amen. And now we'll let Lori take her place back at the microphone, and I will open us in prayer, and we will enter into our worship this morning. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much that we can declare with confidence on the basis of the Word of God, the testimony of Scripture, and the witness of the Holy Spirit in our lives, that you are risen, that you are resurrected, that you are alive, and you are reigning here today, here in our hearts, God. And we just delight to be able to worship you today, to declare that truth and that reality over whatever parts of our lives need to hear that message, God, that you are risen, you are resurrected, you are offering new life to every person who believes in you. May that be true for us as we worship you today. We thank you that you have made this possible not on the basis of our works, our goodness, or our badness, God, but on the basis of your finished work on the cross of Jesus Christ. We thank you for your sacrifice, that you paid the price in full for us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Crimson perpetual tide, kneel down on the shore and be thirsty no more. Go under and be purified. Follow Christ to the holy mountain. Sinner sorry and wrecked by the fall, cleanse your heart.
Mysterious.
was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our sins. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him. He was crushed for our sins. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him. And by his wounds, we are healed. We are healed by your sacrifice. In the life that brought us peace was upon him. And by his wounds, we are healed. We
Hello again, and happy Easter again. They say that you can say a lot about a person by looking at their hands. And this morning, I want to stop and consider for a moment the hands of God. Now, if you have grown up in the church at all, probably even just the little tiniest bit, if even it was just your grandma once upon a time used to drag you kicking and screaming to Sunday school, most likely you can remember sitting in that Sunday school class and singing the song, "He's Got the Whole World in His Hands." Right? It's this amazing song of confidence and comfort that there is this God who is able to uphold and carry everything right in the palm of His hand. But for me, as I grew up in the church, that message must not have sunk in, because I remember growing up in my childhood and my youth and into my young adulthood being very afraid of the hand of God. His hand was not the one that upheld the world, but it was the one that was held threateningly over it, ready to crush us all, and me in particular, for every mistake that I would make, every time I would slip up, I was terrified of the hand of God. You know, it's interesting. to do a word study, to just look through Scripture on what the Bible has to say about the hand of God. And the results are wide and varied. His hand is creative, that with his hands he formed the foundations of the world. He shaped humanity out of the dust of the earth. The Scriptures, the Psalms tell us that the skies declare his handiwork. His hand is powerful. With his hand, he strikes down his enemies. With his hand, he leads his people to victory in the battle. His hand is a hand that guides. It's a hand that points the way for us and sometimes even pushes us along. In fact, in one particular powerful passage in the Bible, God tells Israel to fear not, for he is holding their hand. His hand is the hand of providence, that it offers blessing beyond measure. It offers a shelter from above. It upholds and uplifts from below. You put all of this together, and the hands of God, they are strong and they are mighty. They are able to create the universe out of nothing. They hold back the waters. They destroy the armies of nations, but they are also loving and compassionate and protective and generous. And the amazing thing about the story of Jesus is that the hands of God, in all of their glory and all of their majesty and all of their might and all of their power, became the hands of a baby. Soft, tender, vulnerable, searching, seeking, learning, growing hands. And as Jesus grew from a boy into a man, his hands would have been put to work. First in his home, doing the chores that his mother needed him to do around the house, sweeping the dust of the floor, cleaning the fish, taking out the trash. Later on, he would work in the carpenter shop with his father, cutting and chiseling and sanding and hammering nails. When Jesus entered into his years of ministry, much to the chagrin of the religious leaders of Israel, it was his hands that would reach out and touch and heal the lepers. It was his hands that would touch the eyes of the blind. It was his hands that would reach out and lift up the head of the prostitute as she lay crying, condemned, where she was tossed on the ground. And ultimately, it would be his hands that would be pierced as he was nailed to the cross. From his hands poured the blood that was freely given as a sacrifice for the healing of all of humanity from the disfiguring disease of sin. That the hand of creation yielded its strength and its power and its might and its life to death at the hands of the very people that he came to save. In that final moment as Jesus was dying on the cross, what were his final words? The last words of the crucified Son of God. Here's the testimony of the Gospel of Luke chapter 24. It was now about noon, and darkness came over the whole land until 3 in the afternoon. For the sun stopped shining, and the curtain of the temple was torn in two. And Jesus called out with a loud voice, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." And when he had said this, he breathed his last. Father, into your hands. Before time had begun, the Father and the Son had walked in lockstep with one another. Throughout his earthly ministry, Jesus had made it clear that he and his Father were one, that every word that he spoke was the word of the Father, that every act that he did according to his Father's will and his Father's way. And so it should come as no surprise to us that at the very end of his life, his commitment was to trust the Father, to die his death in the same way that he had lived his life. And even though through that darkest of darknesses of the cross, when Jesus bore the entire weight of humanity's rebellion and our rejection and our betrayal of God, that when the Father's justice was poured out on Jesus instead of us, that when that moment when Jesus felt for the very first time in all of eternity the abandonment of his Father, Jesus still held tightly to this truth and this commitment that his Father's hands were still the hands that could bring life out of death, that could snatch victory from the jaws of defeat, that would uphold his broken heart and redeem his humble spirit. Jesus had already endured extreme violence at the hands of humanity. And here in this moment, he was ready to yield himself back to the hands of his Father, because he knew that his Father's hands could be trusted. That it would be in his Father's hands that he would be held, that it was in his Father's hands that he would be healed, that it was in his Father's hands that he would be restored, that it was in his Father's hands that he would be resurrected to new life. That in his death and in his resurrection, the Father would undo death itself. That he would undo the curse of creation. That he would loose the chains of sin that had bound humanity. That he would break the slavery of Satan and the tyranny of evil. That he would bring through the resurrection his Father's love to bear against a world filled with the hatred of humanity, that he would bring his Father's light to chase away our darkness, that he would bring the Father's life to set us free from the fear of death. There was once a song I listened to when I was a young man, and one of the verses said, I read the book and it said you died, and I turned the page, you were alive. Luke chapter 23 gives way to Luke chapter 24. On the first day of the week, very early in the morning, the women took the spices they had prepared and they went to the tomb. But when they entered, they did not find the body of the Lord. While they were wondering about this, suddenly two men in clothes that gleamed like lightning stood beside them. In their fright, the women bowed down with their faces to the ground. But the men said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here. He is risen. Remember how he told you while he was still with you in Galilee, the Son of Man must be delivered over to the hands of sinners, be crucified, and on the third day be raised again." Then they remembered his words. When they came back from the tomb, they told all these things to the 11 and to all the others. It was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and the others with them who told this to the apostles. But they did not believe the women, because their words seemed to them like nonsense. Peter, however, got up and ran to the tomb, and bending over, he saw the strips of linen lying by themselves, and he went away wondering to himself what had happened. Today, we celebrate Easter. We celebrate that the cross has given way to the empty grave, that love has triumphed victorious over hatred, that light has defeated the darkness, that life has put death in its grave, that the yielded spirit of Jesus Christ comes forth, bursts forth in resurrection glory. And when that happens, and when we know that and believe that and receive that, nothing is ever going to be the same again. And now, today, more than ever, We need to be reminded of the meaning of this day. That there is no hatred that we may face in this world that love cannot overcome. That there is no darkness that is so deep that the light cannot pierce it. That there is no fear that we may have in this world where the hope of eternal life cannot break its chains. And the challenge for us, both for the believer in Jesus Christ as well as the unbeliever, the challenge of the message of Easter is, will we, like Jesus, commit our spirits to the hand of God? Not just to bring us life after death, but to bring His resurrection power into all of the little deaths that we face while we live. To trust that this Jesus, the risen, resurrected Jesus, is going to bring life into our broken relationships, into our broken dreams, to our broken hearts, and to our broken minds? Are we going to commit our spirits to God and trust Him to love us, even when we are in the middle of the mess of our own mistakes, even when we feel unwanted and unworthy? Are we going to trust Him to light the way in our lives through the darkness of our own trials and through the maze of our own temptations? Are we going to trust that though this moment of death that we may be feeling right now, whatever that death may be, whatever death we may be dying in this life, whatever loss we may be grieving, whatever battle we may be fighting, whatever struggle we may be facing in life, this moment of death is not the last moment. That for those who commit their spirits to the hand of God, there is a moment after this. There's a resurrection moment. And for those who believe in Jesus Christ, that resurrection moment is eternal and has a glory that far outweighs these light and momentary afflictions. My prayer for us is that today we will embrace this moment. We will commit our spirits to the hand of our Father. And we will experience His resurrection power for us, in us, and through us. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank You for the cross, for all that it has secured for us, all that Jesus has done for us in bearing the weight of our sin and its responsibility and ultimately its consequences, that You have endured the wrath of God in the cross of Jesus Christ, that You have paid the penalty for sin, that You have ransomed us from the grave and from captivity to sin and to Satan, and that You have all done all of this through Your sacrifice on the cross. But we rejoice all the more that even that sacrifice is not the end of the story, that there is this promise in the resurrection that a new kind of life is possible, a resurrected life, a risen life, where we are given new hearts and new minds and new purposes and plans by You. I thank You for these promises, Lord. And I pray as we celebrate this Easter, God, that we would not just look at it as a historical event sometime in the past, God, but that today, right now, and every moment that follows for the rest of our time here on earth and beyond, we would commit our spirits to the hands of our Father. That Your will would be done on earth in us as it is in heaven. If you're listening to this morning and you have not placed your trust, you have not committed your spirit to the hands of God the Father for salvation, for forgiveness from your sin, and for the freedom that He has freely offered to you on the cross, I want to invite you this morning to pray with me this prayer. Heavenly Father, I confess to You that I am a sinner, that I have denied You, that I have betrayed You, that I have rebelled against You and rejected You. and that what I deserve for that is death. But what you have offered me through the cross of Jesus Christ is everlasting, abundant life. And I receive that gift from you today. And in receiving that free gift of salvation through faith in the cross of Jesus Christ, I commit my spirit to you, that your will would be done in me. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. If you prayed that prayer for the first time this morning, I would encourage you to take the step of faith. Let somebody know who is a believer in Jesus Christ that you have committed your life to the hands of God the Father. And let them know, and they can help you. If you don't have somebody like that in your life, you can contact us here at the church, and we'll be glad to find ways to help you grow in your knowledge and in the grace of Jesus Christ. You might even just send a little message on YouTube or Facebook right now. We've got Elder Greg over there listening, and he can jot down some notes on who he needs to reach out to, who we need to reach out to. But we encourage you to follow up with that commitment that you've made. And part of our follow-up with what Jesus has done for us is to respond to him in an attitude and spirit of worship, thanking him for all that he has done. And so I encourage us in our homes right now to do that as we sing these worship songs to him.
Wonderful, merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and friend. Yeah.
was as black as could be. Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin, dwelt among men, my example is he. The word became flesh, and the light shined among us, his glory revealed. Living he loved me, dying he saved me, buried he carried my sins far away, rising he justified. One day they led him up Calvary's mountain. One day they nailed him to die on a tree. Suffering, anguish, despised and rejected, bearing our sins, my Redeemer is he. A hand that healed nations stretched out on a tree and took the nails for me. Living he loved me, dying he saved me, buried he carried my sins far away, rising he justified freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day. One day the grave could conceal him no longer. One day the stone rolled away from the door. Then he arose, over death he had conquered, now is ascended, my Lord evermore. Death could not hold him, the grave could not keep him, rising again. Living he loved me, dying he saved me, buried sins far away, rising he justified freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day. Far away, rising he justified freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day. Living he loved me, dying he saved me, buried he carried my sins far away, justified freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day. glorious day. Oh, glorious day.
Covered in sin and shame, and you rolled that stone away, and they did everything they could so that they could say it was a farce, or that it was something that we did in order to make our statements true. But Jesus, you proved it, and you have shed your blood on the cross and risen over death, and we love you so much for it, and we pray all of this in your heavenly name. See a victory, Joe.
Do you?
Yeah.
Me too.
The weapon may be formed, but it won't prosper. When the darkness falls, it won't prevail. Cause the God I serve knows only how to triumph. My God will never fail. Oh, my God will never fail. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. Oh, the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. Oh. There's power in the mighty name of Jesus. Every war he wages, he will. Oh, I'm not backing down from any giants. I know how this story ends. Oh, I know how this story ends. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. What the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. You take what the enemy meant for evil. What the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. I'm gonna see your victory. I'm gonna see your victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see your victory. I'm gonna see your victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see your victory. I'm gonna see your victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord.
One more time before we finish. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
And now may the God of peace, who brought up our Lord Jesus from the dead, that great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, may he make you complete in every good work that you do for his will, working in you what is well-pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen.